So the hat tricks are complete. So much new art in the game. In fact, so you can throw your hat. You can run around without your hat. Let me just give you an example. I haven't even done this yet to see how many new frames were actually added for the player. As you can see from that, there are a lot of frames now for the main hero. But it's worth it, I think. All that drawing and everything turned out so everything is smooth. Watch, like if I stand here, throw my hat, there's a lot of animations that he's doing right there that are with the hat, without the hat. So, like you can even pull your sword without your hat. I just noticed his hair went the wrong way for that one, but oh well. So that's really cool though to have this hat, to be able to throw your hat. I think it's a really cool, unique way to do a boomerang style. And I was gonna do some kind of like cord, so you would have like a string or a cord or something like that attached to it, but I haven't even tried it because I kind of like it the way it is. It's a hat. If it were spinning, you kind of get the impression that physically, if you spun a hat well enough, you could get it to come back, almost like a pool ball that's hit at just the right angle. You know, like it's probably not physically possible, but in the sense, it kind of makes sense anyway. So I'm just going to leave it as it is for now. And I'm going to focus on getting some cool enemies in the game. Right now, this is one of the cheesiest enemies in the game. Super cheesy. So I want to draw some cool enemies and start filling up this level one with some rad enemy energy. So I'm going to draw something I got in my head here. It's, let's start with 48. No, let's do 32 by 48. And I want to draw a demon with a goat skull helmet. A lot of the enemies in this game are going to be demons / cyborgs / basically ancient. It's an ancient army, but it's fueled a lot by technology. So this kind of cow skull head type thing this guy's going to have is actually kind of like a technological helmet. So I'm going to do a red color. Right there, slightly orange red. I'm gonna start with a base color that's really dark and more saturated. It's almost too, there we go. Just a little less of that reddish red, more of this orangish red. That's pretty good. Now, going with some kind of like goat-like legs. And I'll give him claws. So I want them to kind of have like a kind of like tuft around his waist. Furry stuff. Oops. Okay, so this bottom color needs to be darker. That's better. Okay. Get it like a bone color. This is pretty good actually already. Bone, yeah. Shoot, I'm gonna keep it like that actually. Okay, so going for a cow skull helmet thing. I've got a cow on my wall I'm looking at. All right. Find a color for this dark bit of this bone or the horn. Yeah, this is looking good actually. Nice, man. I'm happy with this already. Let's see. Give him some cool, intricate nesses. This more saturated shadow. Not too much. Okay. Thinking like a piercing blue colored eye. It's not evil enough. Three or four eyes. Also, yeah, that's way more evil, but if he had a different color, this eye color, this super blue, is just not evil enough. Purple could do. Green could do. Go with the really purpley red. Actually, yeah, if I do a little bit of that. There we go. Yeah. Make this kind of lumpy almost. There we go. Very cool. Now I want a slightly darker color underneath these eyes to give them a little bit of a sunken look. Maybe some taller horns. Ooh, that's definitely dangerous looking. Awesome. All right, slightly more goat-like legs. I'm gonna try a high, a brighter color here for his, like, almost gorilla-like patches here. Yeah, this guy's turning out good. I wonder if he had like flaming nipples. That's funny, but no. Awesome. Okay, I love this guy. I'm going to throw him in the game. And instead of... I'm going to name him something cool. Instead of Demon A, what's this guy's name? Drobth. This guy's name is Drobth. And I'm actually going to call this, this is going to be an idle animation. We're going, we're good. All right. So area, when I hook up enemies, what's up, Mr. Cryptic? Thanks for joining the stream. This is the enemy I'm working on. His name is Drobth. I'm gonna animate him and put him in the game right now. Drobth. Okay, I gotta make a profile for him. Actually, I'm just going to rename Droid B because Droid B is stupid. Drobth. Sweet. Glad you think of it. He's awesome. Drobth. Percent D. So that'll load a couple. I'll just load one frame for now. And we're good to go there. So, see how he looks. He's not going to be animated yet, but at least he'll be in the game and I can make sure his hues and values and everything are about right. Oh, and Mr. Cryptic, if you haven't seen, you can throw your hat now. So that's pretty cool. Oh, there's a bug here. I must have missed one of the frames. What do we got? Drop zero. Missing. Oh, because I named it idle. Okay, so I need Drobth. Idle. Zero. Nice. Oh, these guys are sweet. Can't wait to animate them. Sweet. Maybe a few too many of them. But, yeah. That's what's so great about making video games is when you wish something, you can make that wish come true. I wished I could throw my hat at people too, and it would just fly back. This guy can. Okay, so this is his idle. I'm gonna make a nice little idle animation, three frame, probably. Probably just sit there breathing. Okay, there's frame zero. So I want his belly to extend even more, his shoulders to sag. A little more of a hunch in his shoulders. little more lean in his chest there. Belly extends. Okay. Create a video timeline. Make this 0.1 seconds. No, more, 0.5 at least. And then, that was frame one. So this is frame zero. And I can duplicate that, throw it on the other side. Loop it forever. Belly gets huge. Maybe a little less belly. Okay, so his arms are too static. This frame, I want the arms to move, just rotate slightly. So that was too much in, maybe not enough in, yeah, okay, so this frame, actually I'm gonna do a similar thing to this arm. His left arm just needs a little more rotation in the original frame. There we go. That looks good. Too many pixels right there. Okay, that's good enough for these idle animations, which probably won't even be used that much. Idle zero. Idle one. Idle two. So now to get him to walk. Just call this draw walk. Delete these frames and start with just this frame. I'm going to duplicate, make six frames, all starting with zero. So, Mr. Cryptic, what's your story? Do you work on games or play games or what? So let's do right arm forward, left leg forward. Ah. It's fun to just play with the pixels with this just by rotating them, because they come out so gritty and just messed up that, but they kind of are accurate in the same sense, so it really is fun. So this one, his this is going with his left foot forward, right arm back. Okay. So right arm, this right arm is going to go back even more. So much so that I think I'm even just going to delete most of his left arm here for this frame. Putting this arm on its own layer so I can mess with it above the other layer. For this part too, I think the horns are even gonna get at a different angle, so. Now I'm going to jump to frame 3. What's up, Mr. Snapping Turtle? How long did it take to get to that level of pixel art? Well, really not that long, man. I've only been making art for a couple years. And I've really been only making pixel art for a year now. So, yeah, not that long. And if you're looking to get into making art, I did a video series about that, about the basics of it. It's called From Programmer to Artist. There it is. It's this fourth one down, Wizard Foo. It's just a short video series about going from programmer to artist. And I get a lot, like people asking how to become an artist or how to do art or how long does it take to get good at art and things like that. So that's kind of an introduction to what I would say to anybody that's learning about that. So I hope that helps. Sweet. So I want this leg. Okay, so this one he's, I'm jumping forward to frame 3 where his right foot's forward and his left arm is back. So this one I'm going to make is a slight move. So right arm forward. No, right leg forward, left arm back. Wait, did I mess up on the first one then? I did. Dang. This one left leg forward, right arm forward. Okay, I totally messed this one up. But I can salvage the upper body for this actual frame. So I'm gonna call this one 3. So 3, yeah, we'll just do 3 now. And then delete these legs. Okay. Right arm back, left arm foot forward. No, wait, right arm back. I'm so confused today. Right arm back, right leg forward. Yeah, okay. So this one, this is as his right leg going forward. And only slightly, he's a goat, so he doesn't really move. He has goat legs, so he doesn't really move his legs that much. More like a little prance or something. And this is frame. Oh, dang, this is supposed to be frame 3, so dang. Okay, this one is actually 4. Okay, frame 4. So this leg actually is going to move a little farther in frame 4. Maybe just, yeah, that's good. Okay, and this leg back a bit. Yeah, so that's got his head turned, his body fully extended in this kind of pose. So that's 4. All right, we got 4, we got 0. 0, is he right? Did I do this right? Think about this. His left leg is forward. Yeah, this one's right. Okay. And then this one, we want to take this kind of effect, but extend it even further. So this is this frame is the left leg going really forward. Oh, sorry, Mamassi. We were talking about, oh yeah, thanks, Mr. Snapping Turtle. You guys are awesome. Awesome listeners. Thank you. It's great to have people that are helping each other out and that just positive forces, you know what I mean? So this one, the left leg arm is going to be at its full extension. Which shouldn't be that much. I want to put more of a crook into this elbow here. Oh, whoops. This one is, this arm's going to go back. And then add this little bend here to the elbow a little bit. In this frame too, I think his belly is going to be a little bit more front on. So there, I'm making his belly just a tiny bit wider. Okay, and then legs. So his left leg's coming forward. So I'm going to cut his left leg or his left leg to a new layer. Just make it easier. And then I'm going to move his right leg back a little bit and then rotate it. That's good. Clean up the pixels just a little bit. And then now that I've got this other leg on its own layer, it's easier to move. Once again, the goat walk is kind of like a more of a prance. So there, that looks good. It's delicate pixel art. You gotta get, it's like one pixel makes a huge difference. So because his foot is really forward, I really want this I need to make his hips look like they're moving too. Okay, I think that's gonna do for frame one. Zero, one. And then I'm gonna do, for now, I'm gonna duplicate or just use zero as two as well, and then three, four, three. Okay, so this is the last frame before we can test it. So three, this is where. This is a right arm back, right foot forward. So the right arm is going to come slightly back. Probably easiest to cut this to a new layer and then move it behind. So I'm going to cut it. Put it behind and then rotate it just a little bit. And rotate at the elbow. So this is right arm back, left, right foot forward, and this is the partly extended one. I'm just gonna keep reminding myself. There, that foot's just a tiny bit forward, and maybe just a tiny bit rotated. Now, this arm is forward. Okay, and then a little bit of cleanup. It's good. And then this foot, last thing. This leg is gonna go back. Okay, so this is ready to try out. Probably need to make him bounce a little bit too. But should have enough frames to see how this is gonna look, so. Yeah, it's super robotic because he's not bouncing at all. If you just add a little bit of loft in, say, this frame. So another thing is this, his horns in this frame. Be nice if they, there was like an intermediary frame where they were almost like the ones. So I'm gonna do that by, actually I think I'll just move those. Yeah. Yeah, oh yeah. Gosh, that added a lot right there, just making that slight adjustment. Wow, dude, I think he's ready to throw in the game. Cool. I only needed to do like 4 frames or something for this whole thing. So I'm going to delete the frames I didn't use just so I'm not confused later when I come back to this animation. So I didn't use 2, 0, 1, 3, 4. Okay, so 2's gone, 5's gone. The 4-frame walk, that's pretty decent. Cool, all right, throw this guy in the game. Stop, okay, this is drop walk 0. There's one. Two. Three. Four. Five. So he needs a, they're called run, but it'll actually be a walk. Drop walk. Frame count 6. See how that looks. Why aren't they turning around though? Oh, I know what it is. They're all backwards. Dude, they're moonwalking the whole thing. Okay, so this is easy enough. Just flipping him over. Gotta re-export these frames. Image, mode, or rotation, flip, horizontal. So all my enemies and everything start with facing right. And then flipping them in the game. So it's super easy. This guy's gonna be fun to make sound effects for. In fact, we'll do that right now. But this is on 4. Which one is this? 0, 1, 2, 3. 4. I need to open up his idol as well. Flip that over. And I need to make this AI cooler too. Probably give it an attack so it's not like. It's not like you just run into the enemy and, ooh, you just get hurt that way. Which is very Legend of Zelda, which I'm trying to, like, go for. Original Legend of Zelda here. But I think I do want to do more advanced AI than Zelda did, so. Probably need to do some kind of AI to make this guy cool. Yes, they're very intimidating. Dang. I don't want to get anywhere near them. Kind of stupid, though. It's actually really cool to get away with so much life with just 4 frames of animation. Why aren't they even getting anywhere near me though? There we go. So they need a slightly bigger need bigger collision area. The lighting is all custom. I did a my own shader for it. So it's actually took me a 3 or 4 solid days just to make the shader. But I'll explain how it works. Every single sprite in the entire game has this shader applied, so it can all be done in a single pass. So usually to do an effect like this, you would need to do multiple pass rendering. So you'd render everything to one frame and then apply some lighting to it all. But the way this works is that every single sprite gets the shader, and then you basically have to pass in the position of every sprite to the shader. So the shader needs custom variables for every single sprite it renders. So that way though, each sprite can know where it is in the scene, and then each sprite during the shader also needs to know where all the lights are. So there's only one light on this screen, but there's 3 lights on this screen. There's a 1 light for the player, and then there's 2 lights for these 2 flames. So the shader actually goes and finds the closest flame and uses the lighting based on that, and then applies the position of its where it is in the world to determine how light it should be, basically. And then I actually looked up some how Photoshop does its shaders, or not its shaders, but its blending. So I did some effects in Photoshop and really wanted to duplicate how good they looked, so I did like 30% blending of sort of a color burn, and then like 30% of a soft lighting, and then some levels. And so that's why the shader shines when it gets over the water, because it's got a little bit of color burn as well to it. So that's kind of how it was done. I hope that kind of helps you. What's up, Modeza Libraries? This is CocoStudioX. I'm using for my library, for my game engine, and then on top of CocoStudioX, I've written a custom engine for this game. Yes, exactly. So yeah, the fizzling at the rim of the light and all that is totally based on color burn. So if you guys, like the article I used, where is that article? This is a really good article. So for whatever your game engine you guys are using and stuff like that, Photoshop like shader. Is that it? No, it was on Stack Overflow. Yeah, that's kind of the point I wanted to go for, was not to slightly subtle, but yet still looking pretty cool. So, it was Stack Overflow, Photoshop, blending. Here it is. How does Photoshop blend two images together? So remember that search. All I searched for was Stack Overflow Photoshop blending. I even spelled it wrong and it found it. So here it is. This is all the math behind them. And then I just totally just, when I was basically making my shader, I used soft light and I used some color burn as well. But, you know, you can play with your own effects and get a totally your own thing here. Yeah. You're welcome. So, okay, so getting back to this guy. Also, I need to make some kind of cool dying animation for him. That's what I'll do next. Yeah. So when he dies, he'll... Oh, and I want to do some black blood. So he, like, sprays some blood or something when he dies. Okay. So I'm going to make him die really cool now. Drop, die. I need to make this one wider. Trying to think if I should make him explode or fall on the ground and then like melt away like acid. Not exploding. Exploding is too... I did that for the blob enemy and that was turned out to be cool, but I think I can do something else even more cool for this guy. Whoops. Okay, I want this to be 64 wide. So I'm gonna do something where it's like he's getting hit in the gut, actually. So this is the first frame. So he's gonna double over a bit. What's up, man? I don't know how to say your name, but thanks for chatting. Turn to smoke or flames? That might be actually pretty cool. He's definitely going to emit like some black blood, but I think I'm actually going to make him fall to the ground and then sizzle sort of. Or maybe, yeah, maybe turn into smoke or flames actually at the very end. Yeah, Kogo Studi X does use a Z buff. Wait, does it? Yeah, I think it does use a Z buffer. It's using OpenGL. T-Farce. Oh, okay. What's up, T-Farce? Yeah, that's a good idea, T-Farce. Some smoke would be cool. Actually, I'll do that probably with some more particles and things like that. Yeah, good idea. Okay, so here he's starting to double over a bit. I want him to squash his legs a bit in this frame. Move them back. No. Okay. Just sort of like give it this look like he's kneeling a tiny bit. You're thinking how secret mana has your sword sticking in the enemy? Obviously not done via Z buffer. Oh. Can you show me a screenshot of that? I can't remember that. I remember playing Secret of Mana a couple times when I was a kid, but I need a screenshot to know what you're talking about. But I'd love to help figure that out. So I'm gonna start with these clean pixels here. Frame 2. Okay, cool. So yeah, he's gonna double over even more now. Probably a lot, actually. This is like, this effect happens quickly at this point. So I'm gonna just move these over here. Basically just rotating pixels at this point and then cleaning them up. It's kind of my process for how I animate. Some artists will go and they'll draw some outlines and stuff like that and then kind of like redraw everything, but I like to do things as fast as I possibly can, waste as little time as I can, and that's why I just kind of like mess with pixels as they are. Really, the only time the character looks clean is the first time he's drawn or his original frame. That's good. That turned out all right. All right. Now he's like partway doubled over. Now he's going to fall. He's going to fall to the ground in the next 2 frames. Maybe 3 frames. Nah. Two to three frames. Maybe 3. I think I'll actually duplicate this one. No, I'm gonna start again clean. Okay, starting with the clean one. I'm gonna put him halfway to the ground this time. So his upper body is gonna be pretty much horizontal. This is actually a nice way to do it, just dragging things out of the way rather than creating new layers and stuff. It's even faster than the other way I was doing it, where I would create a new layer for stuff. So, yay for getting faster. So what is going to happen to his legs in this one is probably... This one's gonna buckle. Okay, so this one's gonna come out. Rotate a bit like that. And then rotate this bottom bit so it's more like it was on the ground. Clean that up. And then so this one, the top is going to rotate back. Get these claws looking right. So why can't I draw? Oh, selected some random pixel there. What's up, Markiplier coolness? Markiplier. That's a sweet name, man. I like it. If I like this arm bracing himself so much, or maybe it's his leg. His leg, yeah, this back leg needs to like flip out, like he's just about to fall down. He's losing his control. That's better, a little bit better. And also, I want him to look like he's more out of control. So, I think this arm is gonna bend a little more. Yeah, that's a little better. What's up, Paul Six? Hello to you, too. I'm animating this evil guy. I'll show you guys what the game looks like and what the guy looks like in the game now. So I just drew this guy just now during this live stream. His name is Drop. And this is what he looks like in the game. He doesn't have an attack yet, but he does hurt you if you get near him. I need to make his collision area bigger. But right now we're working on the die animation, so he just when you kill him, he dies really cool. But I'm really happy with this enemy so far. This is like the first... Really, I haven't even really focused on enemies at all yet. I focused a lot on the player, making the player's animations cool. So this is the first time I'm really getting into making some cool AI and cool graphics for the AI. So yeah, just working on making him die, really, his die animation cool. Gosh, I get these questions like all the time. I need to make this on the like a fact page or something, but I'm making this with Cocoa 2DX. This is C++, and I've written a custom engine on top of this, and the lighting is all done with the shader. We just talked about this as well, but the lighting is done with the shader. It's a custom shader, and also all of these videos are on YouTube archived, so this one will be on YouTube as well too. And it feels like Isaac, because Isaac is also a very Zelda-y game. This is very inspired by The Legend of Zelda. So yes, I hope that answers you guys' questions and stuff. But yeah, this game has been in development for almost 60 days now, and it's just me. I'm a solo game developer, and I do have a small website up for the game too. So if you're stoked about this kind of game, you can follow it at there's links on my page and everything. Are you remaking Zelda right now? Good for you, dude. Yeah, I love Zelda. Zelda's freaking awesome. It's totally worthy of being remade like a bajillion different times, and however people imagine it, you know, it's awesome. Okay, so this one, that frame's all right. Next thing needs to kind of fall on the ground. Okay. Well, if you were to do that kind of effect, probably the easiest way to do it would be to do an animation where your sword is only half as long. Like, you know, would that work? Would that work with your game? And what's up again, Adon? Oh, yeah, the hat. Oh, let me show you again the hat. Yes, I'm a programmer and artist and musician. So all of this is just my art, my music, everything. So yeah, Adon was watching when we started making the hat earlier this weekend, actually. But the hat now has animations for, you know, it flies correctly, but the player also has a lot more animations. So he has animations without his hat on, and it's for everything. So you can even like draw your sword, for example, while your hat is out flying. So yeah, I'm really happy with how the hat flying turned out. That just is really fun. I can't wait to, you know, keep on making these enemies and make this world even cooler and make the procedural generation work even better, because the hat makes it really fun. Sweet. Thanks. So, going back to making this guy die, we need another frame here. Start with this frame, duplicate it. Go frame 4. And this one, he's going to be on the ground. Yeah, so he'll be all the way on the ground this time. Sweet. Yeah, I'm glad the hat flying looks cool, because, yeah, that was a good 2-day project right there. But so worth it, you know? I always want to do some kind of boomerang-like effect for like a Zelda-style boomerang, but I never really had the what to do until somebody suggested, hey, why don't you make his hat fly? Oh, me neither. Yeah, with the sword swing, I definitely need to fix that. That's been a problem for a while. The area is a little bit too big, and also the effect needs to be a little bit better so it actually hits things. And Paul 6, no, this is completely randomly generated. For example, right now I've got a world seed in effect that's the same every time. But you'll be able to play this game and enter whatever mega seed you want, or world code, or whatever you want to call it. So if I set my mega seed back down to 0 or nothing, it's going to start me off in a random world. So it'll regenerate this world every single time. And so before, like, we had the whole random generation is really not done yet. But for example, these enemies are different in this room now. But everything is, the intention for the game is to actually generate everything randomly as well. So this is the overworld. This is where, like, it's like the Zelda overworld, for example. And you can see there's trees, there's rocks and things like that. And all of it is just a one big procedural generation. So there's like, there's a big maze generated for it all. And then there's like styles that are generated for each one. And then the tiles are generated as well. So the point is not to do different rooms and then randomly put them together, kind of like how Binding of Isaac did it. But the point is to really, truly randomly generate it all. Yeah, so the tiles are placed using procedural algorithms, patterns actually. So in my area, like there's a whole bunch of different patterns already, but they need to get better. So there's like a pattern for the home screen, pattern for the sword screen, pattern for entrances, random patterns. Random patterns are being relied on too much right now and they need to get better. But so yeah. Yeah, good suggestions, Massey, for making it better. It definitely needs to be improved. And yes, this is only 56 days, and yes, I'm doing it all myself. And optimistically, timeline-wise, I might be ready for beta in a month or two. Not beta, but sort of like an early alpha. And I do need to get some funding together because, like, I'm super broke. So I either need to do a successful Kickstarter or this game probably won't happen. So that's my goal, is in the next month or two to get my Kickstarter out and alpha build and everything. So, yeah, cool. I'm actually glad that it's giving you that feeling, because on one hand, I really do want it to be serious, but on the other hand, I don't want it to be too serious. I don't want it to be too bloody, too gory, but sort of almost like in the middle. So that's good. That's kind of what I'm going for the aesthetic. So yeah, getting back to this guy. He's all the way on the ground. He's just going to squash right into this hand, so don't need that hand as much. Actually, I'll do one frame where he's almost on the ground. This is a Coco Studi X based game. Yeah, totally, the hat, right. It's like funny almost that you're throwing your hat. And really, the character himself is just funny. He's got no shirt on. He's got a top hat. And once you hear the story and everything, it'll make more sense, because the story is that you're basically a partier. You're like a musician. And yes, I love Coco Studi X. I've worked with it many times. And so that's why I'm so familiar with it, that it's really easy for me to do things in it. So that's why I use it. It may not be the best engine ever, I mean, but it is a really good open source engine, and now it's even got 3D effects and stuff too. So, yeah, thanks, Massey. I really do want to consider Patreon as well. But really, one of the reasons why I want to do a Kickstarter is to put so much energy into a campaign that I actually build a following. So it's about building a following and proving that a game has a following as well. So it's kind of a risk in that sense that I do want to do both of them, Patreon and Kickstarter, but I'm going to start with Kickstarter. And thanks, Rick White Freeze. So if you guys are really stoked about the game, it's just songbringer.wizardfoo.com. And I'm going to redo the website and everything to make it cooler, more like a Tumblr blog. But Songbringer is where you can follow it. So you can put in your email or follow the Twitter or Twitch or YouTube or whatever. But SDL and FML are pretty cool. And what's up, Brian Wibley? Yes, I learned C++ game programming by myself, but that was 20 years ago. So I've been a developer for 20 years and a programmer only for those 20 years until just like the last 2 years. I started making pixel art, and I've been a musician though for 10 of those years. So, the brother of Luffy from One Piece. Oh, thanks, Don. Yeah, and really, I don't really care if everybody gives money, but it's nice to have support from people too. Just even if you like the game and you want to buy it eventually, cool, or whatever. Or I mean, you don't even have to buy it. Like, I'll give you a copy for free if you just help out marketing and sharing with friends and stuff. But cool. I'm glad you like the name. It's the name of your ship, actually. It's a sci-fi game. And I know it doesn't really totally look like a sci-fi game, but it really is, and you'll see more and more of it. But the Songbringer is the name of your ship, and it's a big old ship with a lot of people on it. Oh, I haven't. I'm just started getting started on Tigsaur, so I really do want to start building a following there and like put my devlog on there. So I didn't know there was a naming thread though for Tigsaur, so I gotta check that out. So cool. This is a good frame, actually. I want his face to twist, though, in this frame. So I'm gonna move that down. Move his horns in a bit. Yeah, this is actually kind of cool. And then this last frame, I want him to squish down more, so like the life has just totally left him. So the body is going to get closer to the ground. Shoulder's gonna come down, hips down a little bit, shoulder even more, about there. And then this last, make these horns just like that or so. Okay, that's not bad. I want to try this in the game as it is. And then, I don't know, I'll need to make him kind of like. Okay, so I like that idea. I forget who shared it earlier, but about smoke or flames. So this could be a cool idea where he just turns into smoke after he falls down like this, but also splattering some black blood. That'll be cool. So I'm going to test this out by doing the animation here in Photoshop. So, oh yeah, thanks, man. Yeah, I didn't even know, but yeah, it can be misspelled and still kind of get it. Oh yeah, T-Farce, man. That was T-Farce's idea. Okay, so this is one, two, three, four, five. And this last one will stick for a while. So let's see how that looks. It's like he just gives up. I don't know, it's kind of cheesy. But at the same time, I don't really have that much time to spend making all of the animations perfect, but. Good point. Very good point, Messi. It's that animation right there, those two. Is such a funny die. Okay, I'm just gonna try it in the game actually and see if I really do want to perfect it or not. Yeah, his knees bending, that would probably help a lot, especially right. There and there. Yeah. But I'm gonna see get this exported once and see how it's going first. Okay, so his name's Dropth, and now he needs a die bit, but I call that release in the game. And this can be Dropth die frames. I think there were six frames. Six. Oh, we already got that. Cool. Yeah. I think that's enough actually to get it to run. Oh, I do want to turn my world code back to a constant though, so I know exactly where to go to find this enemy. Thanks, yeah. I mean, I really do. That's probably why I've gotten this far in 60 days, is I do not want to waste time at all in anything I do. And I've written enough games that I know where I waste time at, so I kind of bring that same attitude to art, and that's some of it I do perfect and it takes forever and it's just make it awesome. But like the player, a lot of the player's animations I spend a lot of time on, but in general, I don't like to waste time. Oh man, that worked all right. See, it looks a lot better in the game for some reason when you're not so focused on it. But he does need some smoke or something, so I'm gonna add that. It's kind of a funny die animation. I wanna see it from the left. Let's make sure it works. Yeah, okay, it works either direction. I don't know why it makes me laugh so much. No, it's 20 years of mostly game development, but mostly programming. I've been a programmer for projects and worked at companies and things like that. Yeah, maybe, but this is really the first time I've ever done a game and done the art, so that's why I'm really kind of liking it, and I really do want to do all the art. So, I'm probably going to stick with just myself on the art, music, and programming for this one. What games did I make? Man, way back in the day, 1995, my first video game was called Adventures with Chickens. And it was a cheesy puzzle game. But then I went on to work with the makers of The Seventh Guest was Trilobite. I think they're even a company now again. Trilobite.com? No, this is not Trilobite. Anyways, I've worked for Trilobite. I've worked for other game companies. But then I did do like a stint for a while where I was just doing business programming as well. So, yeah, that guy looks pretty good. How to get him to do a dust smoke animation when he dies? Oh, I got it. Actually, I could put something into his profile. So making this sort of a data-driven type thing. We'll just call it Death Smoke. Death Smoke 1. Or actually, I can make it a Boolean. Okay, so I'm going to put my art pen away for now, actually. Let's focus on some code for a second. Make this code so he dies and looks cool and just splatters some black blood. Death Smoke 1. Death Blood 1. Yes. Yes. There. Okay. So now we got some Death Smoke and some Death Blood. Now, so when it enemy dies, that's in change HP. Okay, got it. So dead Run the release animation. What is all this about? This bit of code here, I don't even think I need this or I'm using this. That was to make an enemy blink when he dies, kind of a cheesy blinking death effect, but I don't even think that's being used. Oh, I can't even see. Oh, maybe it is. Oh, the key action blink. This action actually is important. Wait, no, it's not. Okay. Action delay time. Oh, all this does is prevent the guy from disappearing too fast. It's super hard to finish a game. Oh yeah, okay. That's actually a really good question. Man, and I know what you mean. So many people have that particular trait that's hard for them to finish a game. And for me, it's the opposite. So maybe I can explain why it's the opposite for me. I've always had this like, it's like when I get close to the end of something, or when something is even visually like starting to come together, it excites me. And it's that excitement that brings me through the end of the project, which is always the hardest part of the project. So maybe that helps. I don't know. Maybe if not, let me know. Unreal Engine visual scripting. I haven't used it before and I'm not sure what it is. I don't know if I would have the secret sauce in the sense that I really believe that anyone can change their own beliefs, and it's our beliefs that guide us in almost everything we do. And it's I would venture to say that it's your beliefs that cause you to not want to finish a project. And so I would say I would say to try and analyze that. Analyze your own desires. What is it? What benefit are you actually getting out of not finishing the project? Because something in your belief system is causing you to think that is you're getting some value out of not finishing it. What is the benefit that you're getting there? Because there's obviously something, because we don't do things for bad reasons. We do things for strong reasons. We think that it's whatever. Whatever that is, go find it for yourself. Oh, it's when you solve the hard technical stuff, the rest seems so mundane. Oh, okay. So what can you do to excite yourself in the end? Oh, and you're talking about coding in a picture language? Oh. Yeah, I've heard of that kind of stuff. I haven't used it before, so I can't really comment. But yeah, I hope that helps, Massey. That's really what I do with a lot of things in my own life, and especially with this game. Like, for example, for a while, I was not ever going to share this on Twitch, and I wasn't going to put any of my art out till the game was done, because I thought people would steal it. And like, it's such a silly thing now that I think about it. It's like, well, I finally analyzed it for a long, long time, and I realized that Whenever you share your art, if someone does try and steal it or whatever, and they're an artist, they're going to take something totally different. So it's like, art is like a seed. Ideas are like seeds. The second a seed goes from one person's mind to another, it's going to turn into a different tree, a completely unique tree. So I'm not afraid at all of sharing my art, afraid of sharing the programming or any of this stuff, because I know that you can't steal an idea. It'll change into something else. So I hope that helps. Cool. I want to take a look at that Unreal visual scripting. Oh, right, yeah. Yeah, I've seen this kind of stuff where they do, like, I've seen this not only in other places as well, like in... what is it called? I think actually I just saw it in Unreal. This is how you do shaders in Unreal, right? Oh wow, Unreal's only $20. I never knew that. Nice. Yeah, Curiosity, I would definitely like... I think this is a really cool way to do programming. I've seen somebody build a shader out of with this kind of stuff, and that just looks awesome. Seriously, I think it's probably the future of development. So I think if you're going to learn it and you learn that, that's a good way to start, and it's probably not ever going to go away. Okay, so we've got this, and this delays an amount of time, so that I'm going to put a comment here, because this delay an amount of time so the death animation can play. And we might as well... Okay, so this is right where we would do death smoke. If get all default attribute. Oh, default attribute for key. That's a poorly named function. Sweet. Thanks for helping each other, guys. I'm gonna code for a second here. E.profile default attribute for key. Okay, so I'm looking for the key. No, not vector string. This is death smoke. Okay, so if an entity has the death smoke. It's a value, so I want to do the value dot as bool. Yay. Okay, so now I want to do a bunch of different smoke particles coming off, and that's similar to the bomb. So the bomb, so I want to start reusing this code. So the bomb has its own AI. Bomb, here we go, explosion, smoke. For now, actually, I'm just gonna copy and paste this, and then eventually I'll make a function for it. So, death smoke. So I want these to be black smoke. 8 particles. Sprite.set color 3B black. Okay. See if that makes some smoke. And then I'll make it a function. Okay, so the thing is, it's happening in the wrong position because I don't want, actually when you die, I don't want the knockback effect. So bounce back only if e.health.hp is greater than zero. So actually, might as well just throw this in the still alive bit of the code. So hurt, bounce back. That's how that looks. All right. So bounce back now only happens if you're still alive. I think that's gonna be good. That way you'll die in place where you last get hit, and also enemies will die in place where they get hit. So I'm going to start with... Oh yeah, that's pretty cool. So there, they can get hit once, but when they die, they stay in place. So now these guys... Okay, so that smoke is way too big. See, duration, let's do like a scale. Scale equals, I don't know, 0.2. What's this? Sprite.getScaleY. Oh, that works. Okay. Here we go. So they wanted this to be sprite.setScale and then randf times another scale. And so that scale is going to be even smaller, maybe 0.1. And they need to last longer. Duration, much, much longer. Duration 8. That was getting close. Actually, I want this all to happen after. So... set up a sequence, which then runs. Auto sequence equals new sequence. Okay, so we've got delay. We also need auto callback equals, let's see, I'm gonna make some death smoke into a function now. So I'm gonna do a lambda function for this. Auto death smoke equals, we're gonna need E. There we go. Callback equals new callback call func callback init with function death smoke. Okay, so I'm doing all these releases and everything here because CocoStudiX has its own automatic memory management, kind of like Objective-C, but it doesn't always work right. So I'm manually releasing, so I make sure to keep the memory efficient. Okay, I did something wrong here. It's bad access, but it's not telling me where. Oh. So sequence needs to be initialized. Sequence init with two actions. Action one, delay. Action two, callback. Yeah, sorry about that. Sorry about the screens seeming laggy. They are because I'm using Open Broadcaster and I've got it set at 20 frames per second, so maybe I should have it even less. Because if I have it set at 30, it uses so much CPU that it slows everything down. Another thing I need to do is optimize my game a little bit more, because one time when I optimized my game, it really, really helped the stream. So what you're seeing now is a lot better than it used to be, but still not that great. So this is all right, but I don't know if I want these smoke particles to be circles. I think I'm probably gonna use either gradients or, oh no, yeah, you can't actually touch the stream visually. It's definitely a laggy. Oh, keep the bitrate low? Oh. Let's see if I got that option. Yeah, I don't know if it's going to be able to allow me. On the Mac version, it doesn't have as many options as the Windows version. Oh, here, video bitrate. So I've got it at 2100. What should I set it to? And no, the enemies do not do proper pathfinding yet, but eventually I'll probably add something. Or maybe I won't, because like this is supposed to be a simple Legend of Zelda style game, so I might not even do that. Yeah, exactly. Rick White Freeze, you're exactly right. Every single enemy has the exact same AI as the slime, which is the first enemy I had. Good call. Okay, I guess I will get try and change it to 15 next time I do it. I'll do 15 and maybe lower the bitrate a little bit. Hopefully that doesn't change the quality too much for you guys. And also I need to optimize my game for sure. Okay, so this the smoke, I wanted it to come not at any kind of angle. So this is where it does this action. No, there's absolutely no pathfinding in Zelda. If you pay attention, they all just wander. They just wander. Trust me. I'm talking about the original Legend of Zelda, first one. So if I comment out that one, I get no movement, so that won't give it that little arc of the... I think I want to do a pixel instead, so... That's going to be a straight up square. So the scale is going to be a lot bigger, probably 5. And no, I don't think implementing ASTAR is ever going to be a waste, dude, for your game. Unless you're just trying to totally implement the original Legend of Zelda. And I'm glad everybody agrees. That's cool. You guys are good. Good people. Smart. Everybody knows what they're doing around here. Babe?
Hi, baby. Can I,
I'm streaming right now, but yeah. What's up?
Tatiana and Sean need a ride from the airport. They come in tonight at 2 a.m.
Oh.
Can you grab them? Will you still be awake?
Yeah.
You want me to tell them?
Yeah.
Okay.
Of course.
Thank you. Sorry for interrupting.
Sorry. Oh, yeah. With pixels, it's actually better. Squares. They're not doing the right thing, but okay, so what? Position. Oh, there's the original positioning. This is what I don't want. I don't want the Y at all. I want this to be 0 on Y. But spread out over the distance of... This is 10.0, but I want it to be the actual half the width of the sprite. So that's going to be e.render.sprite.getContentSize.width. Times a half. I want them to be alive longer, so the duration is going to be maybe 2 seconds. And I want it to fade out. This is fading 2. Why is it fading 2? I'm glad I did a custom action for this because the other one, both of these smokes are totally different. So fade to fade out, create duration. I want either of those. And then this is set opacity 255. No, let's do 128 plus random mod 128. Set scale Y bigger, maybe. That might start to be better. Yeah, I have worked on many other games besides this one. Most recently, Hero Bash. It's a cartoony type MOBA. Hero Bash. It's actually now wizardfoo.com/game/Hero Bash. But it's a brawler, MOBA style game for iOS. And it never got much attention because I never marketed it from day one. Just like I was talking to Massey a second ago, I was scared. My friend and I were both in this state where we were like, we didn't want to share our art, we didn't want to share our game until it was ready. We perfected it for a year and a half and made this awesome game, but we never marketed it at all until we finally released it. We spent $5,000 marketing it, and all of it was a completely waste. It like didn't catch at all, and to this day we've only made like less than $100 on this game. We spent $5,000 because we never marketed it. So the lesson to me there was to market from day one, and that's why I'm even doing the stream. Oh yeah, Rick White Freeze, you just know everything, dude. You're like a very observant guy for sure, or girl. You might be a girl named Rick. But you're probably not, so I'm just joking. Just joking. But I didn't want to be assuming at all. So, no, I don't think it's too late to market it now, but the thing is, for me to actually go through with actually marketing it would require a lot of work to actually go back, build a following and all that. So it's better to kind of start new at this point, and maybe eventually after I put out this game, I could do a new, more updates, more platforms, everything. But all of that requires a lot of work. So I just don't have time for it right now. I'm writing this game. Oh, yeah? Totally, man. I can't encourage you enough to challenge your own beliefs. If you're in any kind of boat where you're scared about anything, actually, if you have any fear at all, use it as your friend. Fear is your friend. Whenever you're, you don't even have to call it fear. Maybe it's not even fear to you, but it's an indicator of something in your own mind that is holding you back. Fear, all it does is hold you back from doing things. The only benefit to fear is that it causes you to not take action, and then so you stay safe. It keeps you safe. So really, look at what the fear is benefiting you. Why are you freaked out about streaming? Are you scared people will steal stuff? Or are you scared your stuff's not going to be accepted well? Whatever that is, go and find that and analyze it and ask yourself what benefits you're getting out of it. And then ask yourself how you can get the same benefits out of doing the thing you know you want to do. And that's kind of my two cents on that. So, Ramsey from Vlambeer. Oh, right. Yeah, I've actually, I'm using his, what's it called? Press kit. He's got a cool thing. Oh, your econ is like, don't be afraid to spend money on marketing. Well, I kind of still am afraid to spend money on marketing because of what I went through. But now I know that if I build a following for the game first, then the marketing I don't think is going to be wasted. Yeah. Cool. Good. Distribute. Yeah, I've actually, I saw that too, the latest updates and whatever. And that looks pretty good. Cost money, though. Well, it's only $10 a month or whatever. Something like that. Or no, is that the new... Distributes the new thing that's not even... Doesn't even cost money yet. I don't know. But they do look good. All of his tools look awesome. So did that work? I can't remember what I was just doing here. I wanted it to fade out that smoke. Now there's not even any smoke. Well, it might have something to do with that. Oh, this is totally... Wait, this should be fine. Fade out. Do fade to 128. Yeah, game jams are a good way to get stuff done for sure. Because it focuses, and that's, and the same thing with live streaming. Live streaming is an amazingly good way to get things done because quite honestly, a lot of my days I start and go, gosh, I don't really feel like doing that, or I don't really feel like doing this. But the second I get streaming, then I'm like, I kind of have to do it. So it's a really good way to motivate yourself to do stuff. Okay, that did it. So the problem was the X or the Y position was way too low there. Why is that? So if I go backwards in time, I can see the Y that I used to have was P dot Y. Oh, right. We need to base it off P dot Y. Right here is P dot Y, and then that'll be at the Y, right, Y. So this fade out can now happen. Yeah, time limits also really help too. And I don't know much about the UK market for indie devs, but I really wouldn't even distinguish it that far. I would just say the market for indie devs is worldwide. What's up, Dead Pixel Society? Yeah. Dude, totally. Fear of failure is a big one too. It stops a lot of people from starting anything, you know? And it's all of our fears, but they are, you gotta recognize that fears are rooted in something good. You're trying to do something good for yourself in that you're trying to prevent yourself from getting hurt. So how can you do what you really want to do without getting hurt, you know? And realize that maybe the fear was just silly or something, you know? No, this is a lighting system. All of the shadows are 2D. So this is a 2D engine I'm using. And I basically take the same exact sprite frame. So for example, like when the player's right here, it's the same exact sprite frame, but it's just flipped over, squashed a little bit, skewed a little bit, and then I add a little tiny bit of blur shader to it so it's blurred out. But that's all that is. So those shadows, even on these Moai statues right here, they're the same thing. And they're just flickered a little bit too because they're coming from this flame light. So it's just it's a simple 2D shadow system. Okay. So not quite the entire width. Maybe like a third. They need to move as well. So sprite, run, action, sequence, create. No, I need to, oh yeah, move by right here. Move by, nothing to do with the angle. I want to go straight up. So this is going to be move by 0 on the X and 10.0 plus rand F01 times 10.0. times pixel, we keep that pixel there. That'll put a distance of either 10 or 20. Okay, and then the last thing, I want it to start in an opacity of not quite so black. So maybe just rand mod, no, we'll do 24 plus rand mods 80, and then fade out, okay. Cool, man. Good for you, Dead Pixel Society. Getting past your fears by going to game jams and just doing it. Closer. So I want him to actually fade in a bit too. So maybe set opacity. Fade to create duration of really this very tiny bit of this there, 0.05 20th. Fade to 24 plus ran mod 80. And then fade out duration times 0.95 and thanks, Adon. Yeah, actually I use a lot of the sound effects I make with BFixr. It's a cool tool. BFXR. You can make so many 8-bit sounds this way. And then a lot of the other sounds too, I'll get something on Freesound and make it make something cool out of it. And yeah, you're right. Art for platformers is so much easier. Coliseum Brawl. Is this it? Update number 5, Coliseum Brawl. Dead Pixel Society, this has got to be you. Nice, man. For a game jam, that's a lot of work just to get that done. Cool, man. Way to go. Yeah. A lot of people have that problem. All right. So that's going to fade in a little bit of that. I might even use a gradient instead of straight up square pixels for this. Yeah, this isn't quite the effect I'm wanting for this, but I kind of need to take a break at this point and get some dinner. Probably been streaming for hours now, dang. This is kind of like longer than I usually go. What are we at now? Oh, only 2 hours and 15 minutes. But man, I've really enjoyed all the great comments today, you guys. And I think you guys are enjoying it too. So I'm gonna leave, Can I leave this chat room open? If I close my stream, does it close the chat room? Because I don't want to like shut off you guys' chat. But I am hungry. I'm starving. We need food.